Hey y'all, welcome back to Biblically Blonde. In this episode, we're going to be talking about the story of Gideon, who he is, what happens while he is alive, all of that. It is in Judges 6, 7, and 8. So if you want to hear the story of Gideon, keep watching. Alrighty, y'all. So like I said in the intro to this video, we are talking about Gideon today. Gideon is the he is the fifth judge, because we had Othniel, Ehud, Shamgar, Deborah, and now we have Gideon. And Gideon is kind of a turning point. So the way I like to view it is judges is kind of, you know, you have good, you have bad, and you have kind of in between. And so now we're on the fifth one, and things are going to start kind of going bad. And we see that in the story of Gideon. We see a guy who is somewhat good, he's somewhat bad, and when you finish reading it, you're a little bit unsure of who he is. Is he a good guy? Is he a bad guy? How should I feel about him? I don't know, right? There's mixed emotions about Gideon. So what happens? Let's get into it. Like I said, it's Old Testament. It is in Judges 6, 7, and 8. That's kind of where it's speaking about what happens with Gideon. In Judges 6, we are introduced to him. We are told that he is somewhat of a young man, and at this point in time, the Canaanite people that are controlling them are extremely oppressive. They are not only just taxing them, enslaving them, all of that mess, but they're also taking all of their crops, all of their cattle, everything that they have, they are coming in and taking. So when their crops are rising and it's harvest time, they're coming right in and taking everything. These people are starving. They have nothing. Okay, it's bad. And so God sees a young man in Gideon, and he says, "Oh, you mighty warrior." The irony of that is that Gideon is not a mighty warrior. He's like, "You're talking to me? I'm sitting over here in a wine press, basically trying to get scraps of barley to eat." I mean, he has nothing. He is hiding from these Canaanite people. He is not rising up against them. And yet God comes to him and he says, "You're going to be the commander of my army, and you're going to deliver your people out of oppression." Gideon does not believe him. And he's like, "Okay, so if this is true, will you stay here and show me a sign? But first let me give you some type of tribute." And the reason why he does this is because back in that time, if you were to see God and you were unworthy, you were going to immediately go up into flames. Like, seeing God with your eyes was not something that happened, and it's not something that you wanted to happen, because it usually meant something bad. And yet in this case of Gideon, he's like, "All right, if you really are who you say you are, you're the angel of the Lord, or you're God, then you'll be back when I come back." And it's really interesting. Like, it just kind of makes me laugh, because when you dig deeper into scripture and you see what happens, so Gideon like leaves, like, I just imagine this, like, they're at this rock and God's like hanging out there, and he's like, "So I want you to do this," and Gideon's like, "All right, dude, stay right there, you know, BRB and then he's gone for like a really long time. Like, it says that it's in verse 19, it says, "Gideon went inside, prepared a young goat from an even of flour. He made bread without yeast." This dude's making bread and preparing goats. Like, he was gone for a long time. Like, he wasn't gone for like an episode of Friends, you know, like, he was gone for like hours. Like, I've never made bread, because like, I don't make anything. But I can only imagine that it's taking him a long time to get back. And I can just see, like, I don't really think God hung out there, but he was like back by the time Gideon got back. But it's just funny to me to like imagine like God just sitting there like, "Okay, this dude ever gonna come back? Like, I've been waiting here a long time, you know? So anyway, I digress. This like interaction is just hilarious to me, because he was probably gone for so long. So he comes back and God's like, "I'm here." And God does a like kind of like something with his, he basically sets on fire the offering that Gideon gives to him. And he's like, "All right, cool. So I've been called to do this." So they get this army, and then we move on to Judges 7. And Judges 7, that's when God kind of calls him, Gideon, to actually defeat the Midianites, which are basically just a Canaanite group of people pagans, etc. And so, once again, Gideon is questioning God. And so multiple times we see him saying, if this is true, then do this. If this is true, then do this. And God is very patient with him. God says, totally. And he does it. He comes in and he takes the test and he shows Gideon time and time again that what he is saying is true and that Gideon has been called to deliver the people from Midianites. And so they have this huge, huge army and God says, wait a minute. Your army's too big. If it's too big, then the glory's not going to go to me. And so I need to, like, actually make your troops less. And so we see his troops go from, like, 20,000 to, like, 300 men. Because God just says, take them home. Like, if they're scared, you can go home. If you have a wife, you can go home. Like, all of these things. I think in the final one, if they are lapping the water in a creek to get water with their tongues, then they can stay. If they're drinking it, like, you know, bringing it up to their lips, then they can go. I mean, God's literally like, we are going to diminish this army. So the only possible way that you could win is because of me, because God wants the glory. This is his battle. You know, he's using people, but God wants us to remember that this is all him. This is not Gideon and his troops. This is God's glory. So finally, the night before the battle, we see God come to Gideon. Gideon's test him time and time again. And God, I think, kind of knows Gideon needs another reminder. And so without Gideon asking him, he says, all right, I want you to go down and I want you to listen to your enemies. And you can see whether or not they truly believe that you're going to defeat them or not. And that happens. He goes down, he overhears a conversation, and he's basically given like this huge boost of self-confidence. And he's like, yes, we're going to do this. And they are successful. They're very successful in battle. They defeat them, even though their numbers are like crazy outnumbered. And yeah, the glory goes to God because, you know, only God could have accomplished that task, but he uses Gideon and his troops to do so. So you're thinking at this point, you know, we're in Judges 7. All right, Gideon's cool. Like, yeah, I kind of test God a lot, but he's not super bad, you know. Well, then we get to Judges 8, and we see that in Gideon's great success is when he's going to fall. Not before, but in his success. And so we see a couple of examples of him seeking his own vengeance, not acting upon God. He comes to these two men who he has known previously. We're not given a lot of backstory, but we're basically told that he knows of them in his previous life, essentially, before God had called him to be a judge. And he says, what happened in this battle? And basically we learn that these two men killed Gideon's brothers. And so Gideon, he kills them. Actually, he asked his young son, who based on what it tells us in scripture, was probably all of 12 or 13 years old, to kill them. The son is too scared because he's too young. And so Gideon takes it upon himself to seek vengeance, and he kills these two men. So we're kind of like, all right, so he's doing vengeance. He's seeking his own justice. He's not allowing God to be his Lord, and he's not allowing God to seek justice, but instead he's taking it into his own hands. Maybe this is just a one-time thing. And it kind of is. We see that Gideon is saying that he doesn't want to be a king. He wants God to rule over them. He says that in scripture in Judges 8, but yet the life that he lives is very similar to that of a king. It says that he has many concubines, many wives, and he's very, very rich. And so basically he has a lot of gifts that the people have given him. He doesn't want people to treat him like a king. And he says, you know, I'm going to make this very, very clear that I'm not God. But if you want to give me gifts, that's fine. I'll take them. And so it's kind of one of those stories where it's very, very iffy. We do see that God does deliver the people through Gideon. And there is peace in the land. And that God is following this cycle that I talked about in Judges 2, 3, 4, with all the judges, that he's going to deliver them and there will be peace until that judge passes away. And so it's really interesting because the last time in Judges that we see that there's peace in the land is in the story of Gideon. And so it's kind of a turning point. We're still kind of iffy about him. He's not terrible, but he's certainly not living up to God's standard. And we're questioning, okay, this man of faith. For the first time in Judges, we're questioning who these judges are. I thought these people were supposed to be of great character. Gideon's not terrible. His flaws could easily be forgiven. But, okay, what's going to happen next? And that's kind of the story of Gideon. It's kind of like a what happened story? I'm not sure. Why? I think it's really kind of interesting about why this happened, and I think it's just to accelerate the story. the story of Judges is about how deep these Israelites get into their depravity, how deep they get involved with the Canaanites, how they are not driving them out, and this accelerates that story. It also happens to show us that the people God chooses to deliver the Israelites are not perfect, and in fact, they're going to continue and continue to be flawed. And so, like I said in the earlier part of the video, this is the first judge that we're iffy on. You know, I told the story and you're like, okay, he's kind of okay, but he's kind of not. And it happens like that because God wants us to see that even though he's delivering the Israelites, the more and more they get involved with these Canaanite people and they're not driving them out and they're not doing what God told them to do, the more and more even the people he's calling to save them, the judges, the prophets, they're going to be flawed. They're going to be bad. It's just going to get worse and worse and worse. And so this is kind of, you know, it's just showing us that, nope, you better put your seatbelt on. So what does it tell us about God? Number one, I think it tells us that God will help us out when we ask for a sign. You know, you want to shake Gideon in this story because he just keeps asking God for signs and then another sign and then another sign. And God is patient with Gideon. God says, fine, I'll do it. Fine, I'll do it. You know, and yet in the New Testament, we see when people ask Jesus for a sign, he says, I am your sign. That's all you get. And so I think we should be very cautious of when we ask the Lord for signs, because we shouldn't. We should trust in the Lord. But I think it's also very nice to know that even though sometimes we do, even though we can hinder in our faith, the story of Barak from the Deborah and Judges 4 and 5, you know, he questions God. And while we shouldn't, it's sometimes always going to happen. And so God's not going to hate us if we question him or we ask for a sign. Does he want us to? No. Do we need to pray for the strength to just be able to believe? Absolutely. But if you ask for it, you're not a terrible person. I can't guarantee it'll happen. Most of the time when I ask for signs, it does not happen. My sign is Jesus Christ. You know, I can probably tell you on one hand the amount of signs I've asked for that God has shown me, because we need to trust in the Lord and know that he is our deliverer and just know God's word, and that's our sign. Your sign is the Bible. Your sign is his word. But just know that if you do that, you're not terrible. God was gracious to Gideon, and he did help him out, and he did show him signs even when he probably shouldn't have. And how can we apply it? I kind of touched on this on what does it tell us about God, but essentially know that in the story of Gideon, we see a man who could have done great, great things, and in the end, we're really iffy about him. Yes, he asked God for signs, and he shouldn't have. He should have been true and just known that what God was telling him was going to happen, and yet he asked for signs 4 times, and God always is patient. And I don't really think that's the worst part of his story. I think the worst part of Gideon's story is that even in his success, he falls. And I think that's where we can really apply the story of Gideon, is when we are most successful, that is when we can crumble. Here God has delivered Gideon. And while he's telling the Israelites, don't treat me like a king, I'm not a king, he's also taking incredible amounts of gifts from them. And he is living like a king. He has multiple wives and concubines. He is living in a palace. I mean, this guy is doing everything that a king would do, but he's trying to play it off like he's not. And that was in his success. And sometimes when we are most successful, we can falter. So always remember that God wants to do the glory. You have to give the glory to God. Gideon could have said, you know what? I don't want your gifts. I just want to go back home. I want to live comfortably. I want everyone to be in peace. And I just want to serve my great, great God who has given me such glory to be able to be your judge and deliver you into peace. But he didn't do that. Instead, he took all of those gifts and he decided to go live in a great victory. So that's how we can apply it. Alrighty, y'all. So that is Judges 6, 7, and 8, the story of Gideon. I hope that you enjoyed it. If you have any questions or you want to talk about this crazy judge, put them down below. I'd love to get a discussion going. Don't forget to subscribe. It helps my channel out so much. And if you like these videos, give them a thumbs up. Y'all, I'll see you next time. Bye.